Quest presents an unabridged recording of Hidden Secrets by Mel Sherratt, narrated by Antonia Beamish. Chapter 1. Saturday evening. Kit Harper staggered down the path, realizing that having his hands in his pockets was an unwise idea. He pulled them out to steady himself, inadvertently swaying to the left. No amount of drink would make him stop thinking of the mess he was in. It was all going to fall down around him soon. Saturday night with the lads hadn't gone to plan. First, he'd had words with Scott, who'd stormed out, and then Ben had turned on him too, following shortly afterwards. Within seconds, Aaron was giving him a lecture on what he should and shouldn't have been doing. Kit had told him in no uncertain terms to leave, which he had. And then he'd nursed a couple more pints, sitting alone. What was it with people nowadays? All he'd wanted was a fun night out. Yet whenever Ben was with them, he always spoiled things. It wasn't as if anyone really liked him that much. He was just someone who tagged along because he was seeing Gemma, Aaron's ex-wife. He wasn't welcome at their night outs, and well he knew it, but he always insisted on joining them. None of them had the heart to say no, either. They tolerated him because of Gemma. So, Ben turning up had put a dampener on the evening straight away, no matter how much Aaron tried to laugh it off. Aaron wasn't over their breakup, despite being with Tasha now. Kit passed a house that had lights on in every room, windows and door open, and music blasting out. Several people stood out in the garden singing and raising cans and bottles in the air. He dodged a teenager as she raced to the pavement and threw up in the gutter, her friend holding the hair from her face. He chuckled, spotting a police car turning into the road. The neighbours had obviously had enough, and who could blame them with the choice of music? His mood dropped once the noise quietened, and he scowled as he recalled some of the things that had been said earlier. Ben could be such a dick. It was as if he took real pleasure in winding them up. One minute he was as friendly as anything. The next, he could turn on you in an instant. Kit had seen that firsthand tonight. Since he'd started working with Scott, Ben had shown his face even more. Kit couldn't understand why. He, Scott and Aaron had known each other since junior school. Now they were in their mid-30s. He trusted them with his life. They had a history together. Sure, they all had hidden secrets, but they'd been there for each other through thick and thin. The heat of the day was still hanging in the night air. Even so, it was surprisingly quiet once he'd passed the party. He checked his watch. Couldn't read the time despite drawing it close to his face. It was way past midnight, that was for sure. He hoped Nikki hadn't fallen asleep on the sofa waiting for him. If she saw him like this, there was bound to be another argument. He was in no fit state to do anything but pass out when he reached his bed. He didn't have the energy to argue with her again. They had been married for 2 years. And already he knew it had been the wrong thing to do. Something else he was constantly thinking about. What a mess. Scott had turned on him. Aaron hated what he was doing. Ben wanted to cause trouble. And he and Nikki were practically over before they'd started. Maybe he'd be better getting out of Stoke-on-Trent, packing a bag and leaving everything behind. He laughed. Beer talk. There was nowhere for him to go in any case, nor had he enough money. That was the problem he'd been trying to solve, which had got him into this mess. A few minutes from home, he spied a couple walking towards him. They stopped to kiss, walked a few metres, and then kissed again. Kit dropped his eyes as he drew level with them, letting them enjoy their moment. He turned into the cut-through by the school playing fields. The branches of a tree on one side of the path rustled, a warm breeze washing over him. He lifted his face to it, relishing it on his skin. It was so hot. God, he was wasted and couldn't wait to get home now. He stomped ahead, the light in the lamppost thankfully working, showing the way ahead without him having to watch where he was going too much. Kit had lived in Stoke all his life, grown up with its people through work and play. How many times had he walked this path during the years? It must be pushing into the tens of thousands, the area so familiar to him. It had been on his walk home from school. He'd been dropped off there every night when he'd got his first job. Then it was a shortcut from the pub to where he'd lived with Brooke, and now with Nicky. A noise had him turning suddenly, his eyes widening as he tried to focus. "Who's there?" He stared, but could see nothing. A shadow fell across the path. Something hard caught him on his temple, and he went down like a ton of bricks. The back of his head slammed onto the concrete path, taking the full brunt of the force and making the most awful noise. It didn't matter, though. He was dead before he hit the ground. Chapter 2. Sunday. Allie Shenton stretched across to her bedside cabinet, feeling for the ringing phone which had rudely interrupted her sleep. Her head came up from the pillow, and she sighed when she saw it was barely 6:30. "Turn that thing off," her husband Mark muttered, pulling the duvet over his head. The morning sun shone through the edges of the curtains, framing the window in a fiery glow. After a week of glorious weather, it looked like another fine day was on the cards. But it was her work phone that was ringing, which could mean only one thing. If she wasn't busy with a case, Sunday mornings were always spent reading the newspapers propped up in bed before they'd cook an oatcake breakfast. After that, it would be time in the garden or a long walk somewhere. Perhaps shopping, if she hadn't managed to get any food during the week. Allie ordered most of her groceries online, or she or Mark called at the local shop on their way home. But when she wasn't too busy, she loved to browse around the supermarket. "D.I. Shenton," she said, her voice hoarse after sleep. Then she was wide awake, pulling back the covers and sitting on the edge of the bed. "Okay, I'm on my way."
Why on a Sunday?" Mark protested.
"Because lots of people lose the plot on Saturday nights." She gathered together some clothes before heading for a shower. "Things escalate a lot in summer too. The sun brings out the best and worst in some. Add in drink and recreational drugs and it's a recipe for disaster over and over."
"What's happened this time?"
Mark removed the duvet from his head and looked at her.
"A man's body has been found with head injuries."
"I'll do the shopping then."
She turned to him with a smile, but his eyes were closed. Since they'd got over their rough patch, the last few months had been incredible. They were firing on all cylinders as a couple once more, going through the rounds of interviews and training required to become foster parents. They still had a few weeks to go before a decision could be made. Even so, Mark had brought champagne home one evening in anticipation. He'd wanted to keep it chilling in the fridge, but Allie had insisted it should stay in the garage until they had a definite yes. She didn't want to tempt fate in any way.
"Thanks," she replied. "We can make up for it next weekend."
"I hope we hear from the council by then."
His eyes were open now and he rolled over to face her.
"I can't bear the suspense."
Allie sat down on the bed beside him for a moment. "We're going to make great foster parents." She leaned forward to plant a kiss on his lips. "Now go back to sleep."
"Oh, I intend to."
30 minutes later, Allie was driving towards Caverswall traffic lights. She was on her way to Fenton, one of 6 towns that made up the city, where the man's body had been found. It was next to Richmond Academy on the edge of the Seddon Estate, a school that was now doing well in the league tables after a terrible couple of decades. Despite the early hour, emergency vehicles were already in situ, and she pulled in as near as she could.
At least there weren't many people about to rubberneck yet. Allie hated that the public got to see so much nowadays. With the advent of the smartphone, anyone could be a roving reporter, shooting video and uploading it to social media within a matter of seconds. As she got out of her car, she spotted a familiar vehicle coming towards her and waited for its occupant to park up and get out.
"Morning, boss,"
D.S. Perry Wright greeted her, sunglasses already on. He was dressed in a short-sleeved shirt, the top button undone, but sporting a snazzy tie and navy suit trousers.
"Morning, Perry. I can't believe we got here at the same time," she smirked. "It's obviously because it takes you less time now to do your hair."
Perry had been touchy about losing his trademark blonde-spiked style until his wife Lisa had likened him to Jason Statham. Allie couldn't see the resemblance herself and thought that Lisa was being kind. But Perry had taken it to heart and embraced his baldness. He said it suited his all-year-round fake tan. Thankfully, that had gone as well. No more of the orange glow had been known for. And although she wouldn't admit it, because she'd rather have something to tease him about, he did look much better for the loss of them both.
"Get much grief from Lisa?" she questioned.
"The usual. I was relishing family time over a long lunch, though. I got Alfie the latest Port Vale shirt and one for myself, so we were going to play footy in the garden.
I was looking forward to a bottle of wine and a barbecue. Mark was ready to play chef. Inconsiderate of the public." They shared a smile before somber faces were needed at the crime scene. Arriving at the cordon, Allie didn't recognise the officer on guard, so held up her warrant card.
"D.I. Shenton, and this is my colleague, D.S. Wright."
"P.C. Goodwin," the officer acknowledged.
"Has the pathway been cordoned off at each end?"
"Yes, ma'am," he replied.
"Who found him?"
"The usual."
Most suspicious deaths or victims of assault who lay unconscious that happened overnight were found first thing by dog walkers or runners.
"A young woman out jogging."
He pointed to the other end of the pathway. "She lives in one of those houses there with her parents. Found him here and called us."
"Is she at home now?"
"Yes, my colleague is with her."
Allie nodded her thanks. She and Perry signed into the logbook and prepped in forensic gear. Then they dipped under the tape and walked towards the murder spot. It was a beautiful morning, not a cloud in a deep blue sky, and the temperature was already hitting double figures. She cursed inwardly. They were going to ruin someone's weekend.
Chapter 3. The body was already covered by a white forensics tent. The path ran next to the school football pitch, leaving their investigation open for anyone to see due to link-chained railings down part of one side. Allie hoped there were no matches on that weekend, as more people would notice the crime scene. Ahead stood the senior crime scene investigator Dave Barnett, suited up like a snowman, sweat dripping down his brow. He was showing Christian Wilhorn, the pathologist, something on his phone. Spotting them, Dave raised his hand in acknowledgement.
"Morning, gentlemen," Allie greeted as she and Perry drew level. "What have you got for us?"
"A male, white, 36, according to his driving licence," Christian said. "Goes by the name of Kevin Harper. Blunt force trauma to the side of his head, plus a heavy hit to it once he'd fallen.
Dead as a result of the second."
"It's possible even from the first. Our killer and victim could have had a fight that went wrong."
"Or perhaps he didn't see a fist flying at him in time to dodge it," Christian remarked.
"A fist, you say?" Perry raised his eyebrows. "Not come across a one-punch kill before."
"It's just a theory, but that's where you come in."
Dave pointed downwards.
"His head took a right walloping on the concrete path."
"Drunk, perhaps, or fell heavier than normal," Allie suggested.
"We'll know more when the toxicology results are back," Christian replied.
"Either way, it was no accident."
"You say you have his driving license?"
Allie glanced around for evidence bags, but saw none.
"Yes, it's inside the tent," Dave told her. "His wallet and phone were found on his person, although the phone took a bit of a battering as he fell on it. It's still working, even though the screen is smashed. Needs a passcode."
"Is the address nearby?" Christian asked. He'd recently transferred from up north.
"Yes, not far," Dave told him. "My next assumption is he was on the way home from a night out when he was jumped."
"But not robbed," Allie added, almost as an afterthought.
"Any murder weapon found?" Perry asked.
"Nothing yet."
"Thanks, guys."
Allie took a deep breath.
"Let's take a look and we can get on with piecing together what happened.
Are Frankie and Sam on their way in, Perry?"
Frankie and Sam were the two detective constables who made up the rest of the immediate team.
"Yes, boss."
"Okay, thanks." Allie stepped forward to follow Dave, Perry behind her.
"Timeline, Dave?"
"He wasn't dead long before he was found. A few hours ago at the max."
The temperature inside the tent was unbearably hot. There was a collapsible table set up to the right, several items already on top of it. Jordan Monroe, the forensic photographer, was taking photos of the body and moved aside to let them get closer.
"Hi, Jordan," Allie smiled.
"Mom,"
he nodded a greeting.
Jordan had only recently joined the team. In his 30s, with short black hair, model features, and a strong, firm physique, he was always a sight for sore eyes. However, Allie liked much more about him than that. He was meticulous at his work, spotting things before anyone else and giving feedback on theories that led to great leads. Sweat dripped down the middle of Allie's back. She was going to be drenched by the time they got outside again. The victim was flat out and almost untouched by injuries. The only thing indicating his attack was the large pool of blood at the back of his head. He was dressed in a T-shirt with the slogan of a local band across its front, dark denim shorts to the knee, and white trainers. Two tattoos were visible on his forearm and hand. At least that would make him easier to identify, despite having his details. Allie took Jordan's place and stooped beside the body to get a better look. Hazel eyes stared ahead, olive skin tanned from a recent holiday or time outside. His dark hair was short, tidy, and he was clean-shaven, although signs of a shadow were already coming through. From what she could see of him, he was lean and fit, and on the face of it, healthy. Was this a disagreement that had got out of hand? She wondered if he'd been walking home with his assailant or had met his fate on the way. Or had he simply been in the wrong place at the wrong time? Even though it didn't look like he'd been robbed, something could have been taken, and whoever attacked him left the rest behind to throw them off the scent. First thing they needed to find out was where he'd been the previous evening and who with.
"You say he lives local?" she asked Dave.
"Yes, Beresford Street." "It's a 10-minute walk, I reckon," Perry replied.
Allie nodded, standing up.
"We'll be off soon."
Now, out of the tent, Allie glanced around. Two properties, back to back, bordered the cut through. One had a 6-foot fence, the other a row of conifers that were even higher. Maybe one or both had security cameras they could view, although they probably wouldn't cover the path. It was worth checking out, nevertheless. At the far end, an elderly couple with 3 dogs at their feet were talking to PC Goodwin.
"Since when did they become a couple?"
Perry rolled his eyes as he joined her again.
"Who?"
"Dave and Christian. They were practically finishing each other's sentences."
"It's good to have people who work together well."
Allie thrust her tongue into her cheek.
"Whereas I get stuck with you."
Perry rolled his eyes in jest. DC Frankie Higgins was coming their way, looking fresh and so young. How Allie longed to be his age again. At 28, she'd still been on the beat. Having said that, age was nothing but a number. Apart from her knees creaking and a dodgy back every now and then, she couldn't complain. It wasn't yet 7 a.m. Too early for house to house. For the next hour or so, she'd set him on talking to the locals who appeared and scoping out the area. She updated him on everything they'd discovered so far. I don't want to disturb the residents in the houses that run adjacent to the path yet, but equally I know they'll be drawn to what's going on outside and will come to see for themselves. Keep an eye out for that when it happens and have a chat with them then. Yes, boss. The search team will be here soon, plus Sam is starting the operation off at the station. Perry, let's be on our way. It was time to deliver bad news. Chapter 4. They left Perry's car at the crime scene and headed to the address they had for Kevin Harper. In the car it would take less than 5 minutes, especially this early on a Sunday morning. It was a great night last night, wasn't it? Perry said to Allie as she drove. We should do it more often. Allie and Mark had been out with Perry and his wife Lisa, a rare occurrence that she'd enjoyed immensely. Perry's son Alfie had stayed with his grandparents overnight, so none of them had been driving. Luckily, neither of them had had too much to drink. It was, she said, and really nice of Lisa to chat to us about fostering too. She must get really bored of talking about work all the time. She's happy to help. We both think what you and Mark are doing is amazing, although I will be surprised if you share any Maltesers with the kids. Allie whacked him playfully on the thigh, keeping her eyes on the road. I am not that precious about my chocolate. Yeah, you are. A few minutes later, they turned into Victoria Road, one of the main thoroughfares through the city. Allie puffed up her cheeks and then blew out her breath. Beresford Street, the next right, was a line of terraced houses. There were no gardens, the doors opening to the pavement. Hanging baskets hung proud from umpteen properties, no doubt fixed to the walls securely. Blues, yellows, reds and whites caught Allie's eye as she drove down the road. Rows of cars were tightly packed together, with hardly any room for errors of judgment. Number 18 is where we're after. Allie manoeuvred the car into one remaining space a few metres along. I hate this, don't you? Perry pointed to a navy blue door as Allie killed the engine. Going to ruin someone's Sunday. I hate going to ruin anyone's day, Allie sighed. But it is what it is. Considering the number of cars that were lined up, it was quiet. The curtains were closed at the house they were visiting. She glanced at the clock on the dashboard. 9:05. She hoped she wasn't getting anyone out of bed. She knocked on the door, first fishing out her warrant card. A woman answered, peeping around its frame. Allie held up her ID. Mrs. Harper? She tried first. Yes? D.I. Shenton and D.S. Wright. Could we come inside for a moment, please? The woman's face dropped. Has something happened? If you wouldn't mind... Allie urged. She let them in, showing them through to the back of the room. Originally, the terraced property would have had two sitting rooms, but, like many others, the space had been turned into one room with open-plan stairs running up its middle. The house was cosy, a three-piece suite, coffee table, and a TV crammed into one end, and a table with four chairs at the other. A pile of clothes sat on top of it, folded up, ready to iron or put away. Allie's heart sank as she spied a wedding photograph of the couple on the wall. There were six people, all smiles in a line. Two women and two men stood either side of the bride and groom. All three men had matching suits. The two women wore the same floor-length dresses in a shade of deep pink to match the bride's flowers. "Are you alone, Mrs. Harper?" she asked. It's Nicky. But yes, why? She wrapped her arms around her torso, as if already sensing something terrible was coming. Could we sit down? Allie dropped into a chair before she replied. Perry followed suit, prompting Nicky to do the same. There was no putting it off any longer. I'm afraid we found a body of a man this morning who we believe to be your husband, Allie told her. Nikki stared at them both in turn. Used to the shock that often accompanied the silence, Allie continued, Kevin Harper. He's your husband? Nikki nodded. He was on the cut-through between Fenton Road and Victoria Road. I'm afraid he was pronounced dead at the scene.
He was on his way home.
There was a quiver to her voice. It looks that way. Allie sensed things starting to sink in. Nikki's shoulders dropped, her face ashen. Tears poured down her cheeks.
Can you tell me when you last saw Kevin?
Allie asked gently.
It's Kit, she said. No one calls him Kevin. He's been known as Kit since he was in his teens.
Ah, okay. So you'd prefer us to call him that too?
Nikki nodded. He was out with the lads last night. I thought nothing of it when he didn't come in. I assumed he'd grabbed a takeaway and gone home with one of them. That's what usually happens.
Would that be a regular occurrence, out with the lads?
We go out often as couples, but they all meet every month on a Saturday night.
Who is they?
Scott and Aaron. Scott Milton and Aaron Clark. I think Ben was with them last night too. Ben Grant.
Her face crumpled again.
Oh, God, how am I going to tell them?
We can do that for you.
Allie leaned across and rested a hand on her arm.
We need to concentrate on you right now.
What happened to him?
He suffered a head injury.
You mean he fell and hit it?
No, we don't think so. It seems he was struck with something first. Nikki drew in a breath.
So somebody hurt him deliberately?
We don't know for sure. It could be a fight that got out of hand.
Nikki sobbed loudly. Please tell me he didn't suffer out there all alone.
I would imagine he wouldn't have known too much about it, Allie soothed. I need to ask you some questions to establish Kit's whereabouts last night. In the meantime, is there anyone I can call to come and sit with you?
My mum lives in Cyprus. There's only my friends Leanne and Gemma.
She reached for her phone, hands shaking.
Leanne is married to Scott and Gemma is dating Ben.
Allie sensed they were dealing with a group of close friends, already wondering if that would help or hinder their inquiries. I can do that for you if you unlock it for me. Perry took it from her. Are the numbers stored under their names?
Nikki nodded and Perry left the room.
Allie turned back to Nikki. Can you tell me where the men went last night? Did Kit say before he left?
They go to the Wheatsheaf pub on Arnold Street. They always do.
Now they knew where Kit had been to and from. They don't go anywhere before or after? Allie asked.
Nikki shook her head. They find a seat and stay there all night.
What time did he go out?
About 8:30. He walked. It takes about 20 minutes.
Was where he was found the way he normally would have come home?
Yes.
So he was at the pub from approximately 10 to 9? Do the other men usually get together at the same time?
Yes. Leanne rang me after Scott had set out. Kit goes past their house and we had a chat for a few minutes.
About anything in particular?
The way Nikki shook her head in reply made Allie wonder what she was keeping to herself. It was too forced.
And you said earlier you never thought anything of him not coming home. Is that a regular occurrence too?
Sometimes. If they ordered in a takeaway, they'd most likely go to Leanne and Scott's, as they lived the closest. He'd crash there if he fell asleep. Can you tell us what he went out in? Even though Allie was certain they had the right man, she wanted to be sure until the official identification was completed.
He was only casual, with it being so hot. Long denim shorts and a white T-shirt.
Does he have any distinguishing marks? Tattoos? Birthmarks?
He has a raven on his left forearm and a pair of dice on the side of his right hand. Did you see them?
Allie's heart sank at the look on Nikki's face, eager for her to reply in the negative, to be wrong. But instead, she nodded. Nikki burst into tears again, and Allie knew she'd have to stop soon. But for now, she had to press on. I'm so sorry for your loss, Nikki. But we have to get a big enough picture of Kit, his family, his friends, his life. So I need to stick with the questions for now. Are you okay for me to continue? Chapter 5. Gemma Clark's knees almost gave way when she took the call from the police. She dropped down onto the settee, her hand to her mouth.
What happened?
She asked the detective on the line.
He was attacked on his way home last night. I can't give any more details, but Nikki would like you to come and see her. I'd also like to speak to Ben Grant. I believe he was out with Kit last night. Is he with you?
Yeah, he's here.
Can you ask him to come with you too, please?
Of course.
Gemma stood up, her mind already on the task of getting ready.
Will you tell Nikki I'll be with her in half an hour? There's also Leanne Milton to call. Her husband was with Kit too. My ex-husband as well. I can ring him if you like. Ask him to go to Gemma's.
Thanks, but I'm calling them next anyway.
Gemma disconnected the call and sat for a moment, unsure of what to do. She hadn't taken in what had been said, never mind what had happened. Kit was dead. How could that be possible? The men had all gone out together last night, and Ben hadn't said anything had happened. Neither had he seemed agitated in any way this morning. She was certain he would have made his feelings known if so. She knew how much he disliked her friends. He'd told her often enough. She should have asked the police more questions. She didn't even know where it had happened. Had he been alone, or had Scott, Aaron and Ben been with him? But surely they wouldn't have left him then. And actually, no one went all the way home with him, as he lived the furthest away. Oh, wait. The police had said they were going to contact everyone. So he must have been on his own. A door closing upstairs brought her back into the room.
Ben!
She cried.
Ben!
His footsteps thundered down the stairs and he appeared in the doorway.
What's wrong?
The police have just rung. It's Kit. He's dead. Kit's dead.
She burst into tears.
But I don't understand.
Ben walked towards her.
He was with us last night.
He was attacked on his way home. Didn't you walk with him?
I came away before him. Before any of them left, actually. Do you know what time it happened?
She shook her head, and he sat down beside her.
The police are at Nikki's house, she went on. They want us to go there straight away. They need to speak to you, as you were with him, and Nikki is asking for me and Leanne. You know her mum lives in Cyprus, so we're the closest she has to family.
She sniffed.
What time did you get in last night? I didn't hear you come in.
About midnight.
Did you see him leave the pub?
Ben looked on sheepishly.
There was a spat. It got a bit heated.
What time?
About 11:30.
What were you arguing about?
It was booze talk.
Ben ran a hand through his hair. I can't even remember now.
So you left him with Aaron and Scott?
Ben nodded, his face pale.
Christ, I can't believe it.
Gemma stood up.
I need to ring Aaron.
Won't the police do that?
Yes, but it will break his heart.
He's a grown man, he can take it.
Gemma walked away, annoyed at his dig.
It was only because Aaron was her ex. Ben hadn't got on with him from the get-go.
"What really happened in the pub?"
she asked, getting to the door.
"Why don't you ask your precious friends?"
He pushed past her, going back upstairs. Gemma gulped back tears again. Sorting out Ben would have to wait until later. She did have her friends to think about right now. Aaron, too. But before she could call him, he rang her.
"Tell me it's not true," he said,
his voice cracking with emotion. Hearing it brought on a fresh batch of tears, which she failed to hold back.
"I'm so sorry, Aaron. I can't believe it either. The police want us to go to Nikki's house."
"Yeah, me too."
"Would Tasha still be able to mind Charlotte?"
Charlotte was their 9-year-old daughter.
"Yeah, of course."
There was silence down the line as Aaron digested her words. It wasn't the right time to think about it, but all she wanted was for him to hold her, comfort her in his arms.
"Shall I meet you at Nikki's?"
he said, breaking into her thoughts.
"Thanks. I'll see you there."
She disconnected the call, sighing with relief, glad she wasn't going to be alone to cope with Ben. Their relationship hadn't been too good lately, and it was the last thing she needed to worry about. If the police hadn't asked for him to attend, she wouldn't have taken him with her. Nikki needed her friends around her, not someone she barely knew. And she needed Aaron. Her tears fell freely then.
"Was that your ex?"
Ben said. She jumped, not having heard him come into the room. His tone annoyed her, but she didn't let it show. Instead, she nodded her reply.
"So, you're meeting him at Nikki's? That's going to be awkward, seeing as I'll be there too."
"The police have asked to see you both."
"Oh," he paused. "Your friends have never liked me."
"That's not true."
"Of course it is. I can't take the place of your precious Aaron among them."
"Please don't start." She wiped at her tears. "I'm barely keeping myself together as it is. I loved Kit as if he were a brother, and poor Nikki will be inconsolable. I want to help as much as I can."
"I think Leanne has been doing some consoling of her own."
"What do you mean by that?"
"Oh, nothing."
Gemma couldn't work out what he was insinuating, and quite frankly, she didn't want to think about it right now either.
Chapter 6.
"When did you meet Kit?"
Allie asked Nikki.
"We've known each other since junior school. We all have, except Ben. Ben started going out with Gemma after she and Aaron divorced. Not straight away, after a couple of years."
"Have you been married long?"
Allie suspected not, because the wedding snap looked like a recent addition.
2 years." "Kit was married before, to Brooke. He has a daughter, Danielle. She's 18. Someone needs to tell them as well."
"We can do that for you too. Does she see her father regularly?"
"Yes, but more outside the home. They meet in the pub or he takes her out for something to eat."
"You never go with them?"
"Sometimes, but we don't get on that well. Danielle blames me for the breakup, but Kit and Brooke were over way before we started seeing each other."
"Okay, thanks. Where does he work?"
"At Car Wash City in Longton. He'd been there a couple of months, with Scott."
Allie bristled at the mention.
"What do they do?"
"Scott was asked if he wanted a job there and if he could find someone to work with him. They were after two people to work together as managers."
Allie parked that information for later. She wondered how involved they were with the back-end stuff she suspected to be happening behind closed doors. "Did he enjoy it?" she continued.
"I think so. He didn't really talk about work that much, but he seemed happier.
What did he do before?
He was a security guard at the garden centre. You couldn't believe the things people nick from there.
Allie smiled. So he wanted to do something different.
Kit was always dreaming of bettering himself.
She flicked her hand around.
Who'd want to live here for the rest of their lives? It didn't help that I lost my job 6 months ago.
Allie didn't know what to say to that. It was obvious from her tone that they were struggling. Did Kit have family that live local?
Both his parents are dead and he's an only child. His dad had a heart attack when Kit was 7, and his mum died last year, cancer.
Allie grimaced, hoping Nikki's friends were keen to look after her. She didn't like to think of people on their own after such a tragedy. Often she found it hard to walk away after she'd given bad news, especially the death knock. It was hard to switch off from their pain, despite her training. It was also what made her good at her job, the fight for justice ever strong.
Do you know the passcode to his phone, by chance?
Nikki's eyes widened.
He had it on him?
Yeah, along with his wallet. That's how we identified him.
So it wasn't a robbery? It doesn't make sense.
Tears rolled down her cheeks again.
We're not certain, but nothing seems to have been taken from him.
I don't know his unlock code.
Not to worry, we can take care of that.
Perry came back into the room, nodded at Allie and gave the phone back to Nikki.
Your friends will be with you soon, he said.
Do you have a recent photograph of Kit that we could use, please?
Allie asked next. Nikki scrolled on her phone until she found one she liked.
Will this be okay?
Allie glanced at it. Kit had taken a selfie, a beach and the crashing waves of the sea behind him. There wasn't anyone else around. She wondered where it was. It could easily be somewhere down south, as much as a Greek island. Kit seemed so happy, not a care in the world. He would never set foot on a beach like that again.
Thanks. It's a lovely photo.
Allie smiled. That will do fine. If you can email the image to DS Wright. Nikki looked at her helplessly.
Let me help.
Perry took the phone from her again. There will be a family liaison officer appointed to you as well. Allie handed Nikki another tissue.
They'll be here to help you if you have any questions when we're not here, to keep you in touch with what's going on, and also tell you about any breakthroughs we have. In the meantime, let's make you a cup of tea. Have you eaten this morning?
I'm not hungry.
Allie couldn't blame her, but she needed to see that she was okay before leaving. She decided to wait until her friends arrived. PC Rachel Joy would be here within the hour, too. She couldn't leave Nikki alone until then.
Chapter 7
Scott!
Leanne raced upstairs and banged on the bathroom door.
Scott, you have to come out right now!
What's wrong?
It was a few seconds before he opened the door, a towel around his waist, his hair wet.
It's Kit!
She burst into tears.
He's dead!
Scott frowned, unable to take in what she was saying.
But I only saw him last night.
The police have just called. He was attacked on his way home, that's all they'll say. They said for us to go to Nikki's house. They want to talk to you.
What about?
I don't know, but we'd better get around there.
She paused.
Oh my God, I can't believe it. It can't be true.
Give me 10 minutes and I'll be ready.
Okay.
The door closed and he was gone. Leanne took a deep breath to steady herself, but it didn't work. She rammed a fist in her mouth and sat down on the top stair to stop herself from screaming. The door opened again and she got to her feet, wiping at her eyes. Scott flew past her into the bedroom. The argument they'd had only minutes earlier.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.